harbored a chariot wheel on the Gulf of Aqaba. So on the cover of the book, his late wife, Mary Nell Wyatt, now married to a precious man, Brother Lee. So her name is actually Mary Nell Wyatt Lee. And Brother Lee also has been a very proud supporter of Ron's work down through the years. But Mary Nell was kind enough to allow us to use the picture that Ron had taken of this gilded chariot wheel on the cover of the book Yom Suf. And I'm certainly indebted to this sister for her kindness. I don't think that Mary Nell had ever given permission before to use the picture like this, but she was kind enough to allow us to use that. I knew, though, that discovery had been made. I knew from a documentary called The Exodus Revealed about the story where a Swedish lady by the name of Vivka Pontian, who I have had the privilege to become a good friend of, discovered chariot wheels on the Saudi side. And of course, the main focus that I knew about when this God first revealed this to me was the Exodus Revealed documentary with Dr. Leonard Moeller. I did not know the behind the scenes. I did not know how Dr. Moeller had come to his work, how he had gotten excited and involved in this as well. I know he later wrote a book called The Exodus Case, which some people term as the encyclopedia on the Exodus. I haven't actually read the book yet, but I knew that Ron Wyatt had made a remarkable discovery. I also was aware that there were people that didn't agree with a lot of his findings. They seemed to be too sensational. Many people had said that his work had been debunked on the Red Sea crossing. Even when I interviewed with Chuck Missler, we talked about that very issue. But as we discussed it, even Chuck became more supportive of the idea that Nineveh Beach in Egypt, modern-day Egypt, was the actual crossing point for the Red Sea crossing. So we're going to go into that a little bit. So as I began to talk to my wife about this, I told her, I said, I began to tell her how that the discoveries that were made by Ron Wyatt and Vivka Pontian and the documentary of the Exodus Revealed, and I said to her, I said, this is the big issue about this particular story. Nobody can agree with where the crossing really is. And Ron Wyatt was the first one to bring evidence back to say this is where they crossed. There were arguments for the several places, including the top of the Suez, an ancient lake that was in also just north of the Suez that used to have reeds around it. Lake Menzala, which is on the closer to the top there on the northern side there around the, close to the Mediterranean Sea. But none of these places fit the biblical narrative when you begin to look at what the Bible says. God clearly, even though we know he said, calls it a sea of reeds, Lake Menzala, it is surrounded with reeds all the way around it. But we run into a problem when we look at the narrative, because God told Moses, do not take the children of Israel in the way of the Philistines, which was along the coastline. So how could they have gotten trapped around Lake Menzala? And the other areas that he says were in the borders of modern-day Egypt, and yet the Bible clearly says they were outside of Egypt when they were overtaken at the Red Sea. One of the things that was interesting is when I discussed this with Mary Nell. I asked the question, how did Ron actually discover the dry wadi, the riverbed, that he came down? And I'm going to share with you some of these photos that Sister Mary Nell was so kind to let me use in the book here. So we'll just share with you from the book itself some of these photos here. This dry riverbed, if I remember right, it's about 10 miles, something like that, 20 miles, 30 miles long. I forget exactly how long it is. But God tells Moses when he lines up the people, he's getting ready to march, going towards, going into Midia. And it's at the top of the Gulf of Aqaba where they could easily gone around it. And God does an interesting thing to Moses. He says to Moses, take the people and turn and encamp by Pehahiroth, In Hebrew, it means mouth of the gorges. Pecha Hiroth. And when you follow, when he made that turn, no doubt where he was at, there is a dry wadi, a riverbed, that goes down in between, winding between the mountains there, right down to modern-day Nueva Beach, which is now a resort area there. Once you get to there is enough land on this beach, the only place, in fact, on the Gulf of Aqaba, where you could encamp such a large body of people, of 1.2 million to 2 million people, you could encamp right there. But the thing is, if the Egyptians are coming down that wadi as well, there's no way of escape. You're trapped. You're there, and you're not going nowhere. To the north was an Egyptian outpost, which is the remnants of that is still there today. And to the south, the mountains plunged right down into the sea. So there was no way out. You couldn't go over it. They're very tall, very rugged, very hard to get away from anything. And Moses now is faced with this onslaught of Egyptian army coming at him. And he's trapped at the Red Sea, which there is no evidence to ever support that there were reeds at this location. Now, I explain these things to my wife. You know, this is what's going on. And these are the debates why these different places are. But here we're looking at this image of a group of Jewish people crossing a sea of reeds. And I knew that when Moses turned the Gulf of Aqaba, where they really crossed, a sea of reeds, he was prophetically speaking. Unbeknownst to himself, he was prophetically speaking of a future event, an event that was fulfilled in the Holocaust.
The Belsky family, of whom we saw in the movie Defiance, they're the ones who fought and survived.
The troops are coming. God will not part these waters. We will do it ourselves.
But how?
Not by miracles. We will do it together, by our strength.
As soon as I saw it, I jumped up and I hit pause on the TV and I looked at my wife. I said, that is what Moses is talking about. He had to have been alluding to a future event. Everything.
The question, though, that was eating at my wife was, that's a beautiful story. How do you prove it scripturally? Well, that was the easy one. For the sake of the Christian people that are, let me read this to you in the King James Bible for you. Might make it a little bit easier here. In Jeremiah 23, again, verse 7, I knew this scripture by heart. Never had I ever thought that this had something to do with God, what God was going to show me. In verse 7, therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that they shall no more say, the Lord liveth, which brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. Now, God is referring back to the Exodus. And now he's going to refer to a future Exodus. But the Lord liveth, which brought up and which led the seed of the house of Israel out of the north country and from all countries, whether I had driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land. When I saw Tubia Bielski, now it looks like, by the way, they're hastily led down to the edge of this swamp. That's what it looks like in the movie. But in reality, they were not hastily just led down there. Tubia had lined them up in rows like a soldier. Why? Because Tubia was also a Polish soldier. He had been in the Polish army. Moses was a soldier. And so Moses had lined up his people in ranks. When you look at the Hebrew terminology there, it's like they're lined up in ranks. Have to. You had to line them up somehow. You're talking about 1.2 million people. And then God tells him, turn and go and camp by Pehahiroth. Tuvia lines them up, and the Russian general that comes by, that Tuvia had become very good friends with, says to Tuvia, comrade, the Germans are coming. We either fight like men or we die. There's no way out. And so the way he was fleeing, the way the Russian partisan was fleeing, that's the way Tuvia lined up the men, to go in the same direction they were going in. And then for some reason, now Tuvia knew, he tells them, turn and go to the edge of the swamp. Michael had shared with me, he said, my father didn't play around. He said they were actually, when the Germans were coming, they were all frantic. He said, but he sternly told them, you either line up or I'll shoot you. He had to be firm with them. Because Tuvia, he felt responsible for the lives of these people. At that time, it was estimated about 800 Jews he had in the wilderness there. During the course of the Holocaust, Tuvia rescued 1,200 Jews. The people, I have to share with you some of the testimonies. He was their modern day Moses. Incredible testimonies. The way they loved this man was unbelievable. They take, Tuvia gets them down to the edge of the swamp. In the movie, and I think Ed Zwick's seen exactly what God was doing here. He saw the implications of the biblical side of the story being fulfilled in modern times. I want to share with you what his words were.
And refer to Tuvia as their modern day Moses. He takes on a nature totally different from his brothers in that he wants to rescue as many of his people as he can. Hides them into the woods, and just like the children of Israel, they keep moving about.
It is also, though, historically and biblically true. And the idea of Jews forced to wander without a home from one place to the other, in the wilderness, in the desert, in search of a home, is Old Testament.
Tuvia, when he gets them down to the edge, in the movie, a soil makes the comment, God is not here to part these waters. And they ask him, well, how will we go? He said, we will go ourselves, with our strength, with our courage. When I saw this sight of these reeds, I knew this is what Moses was speaking about. This was...
No one from history thus far has ever put two and two together that they actually cross a sea of reeds.
Moses was speaking about this was the sea of reeds. And why? Notice what the scripture says here in Jeremiah. It says, the days come, saith the Lord, they shall no more say, the Lord live, which brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. In other words, there's going to be an exodus that will eclipse this. But the Lord liveth, which brought up and which led the seed of the house of Israel. Zara, right, where is that? Just find for you in Hebrew. Here we go. Zara bait Yisrael. Me'atz, from the land, from the land of the north. Then an interesting thing. U'mikol, and... The conjunction, the word and in there, implies something totally separate. U'mekol ha'aretzot asher hadechatim sham ve'yashvu al adamatam. From all the other lands where God had driven them, he would bring them back to their own land. Why did he separate the North Country from the rest of the world? Now, I know that there were more Jews rescued out of Russia than just the Bielski family. That's true. Russia is the North Country. This is what I pointed out to my wife when she said, how can you prove this biblically? I said, God wrote about it through the prophet Jeremiah. Why did he separate the North Country? Sufuna, why does he separate them from all other parts of the world? And then compares it to the Exodus. Now, scholars agree, Jeremiah 23 here is no doubt speaking. Both rabbinical and Christian scholars agree. This is what's happening today. Rabbi Daniel Lappin, he made the very comment. It's on the back of the book. I believe Steven Denoon is onto something. He actually emailed me this. He said, I believe you're onto something. I heard this from many rabbis. Rabbi Daniel Lappin, though, is very well known, so I quote him. Chuck Missler, in the interview, made the comment. He said, I believe that
the reason this is so intriguing, we're following threads that may not have been followed by looking at the backside and realizing that the whole thing is literally designed.
Attention. Dr. James Dobson also was supportive of the story in an email that he sent to me as well as the book Israel, Are They Still God's People? Interesting things that have been said. Dr. Kenneth Hansen, another Hebraic scholar, he actually does the Kabbalah, teaching a Christian man there that also was supportive of this work as well. A lot of people have been interested in the story. Even Sid Roth asked me about the story on this particular issue here. It is remarkable in itself. Now, after I knew that this applied to it, and as I began to do the research on the story of the Sea of Reeds, it was amazing the things that God began to reveal to me, and the things that he began to show me in response to this as well. One of the most powerful and compelling things that God showed me in this here is that the similarities between the Bielski family and the Exodus story there, or the Bielski Ultriad and that story there, and the actual Exodus are unbelievable. The swamp in which the Bielski Ultriad crossed is 8.5 miles, roughly 8.5 miles across to the island that they hit on. The movie shows some of them being killed when they're fighting the Germans, but Michael Bielski told me, the ironic thing was, no one was hurt. Not a single person was hurt. He said, and yet the bullets were flying over their heads like crazy. The Germans literally tried to follow them into the swamp, but were unable to do it. Just as the Egyptians tried to follow Moses into the Red Sea, and they were all drowned. In Nechama's book, she quotes Chaya. Chaya, by the way, is the wife of Asoil. Asoil was later killed in the war because he continued to fight, and he ended up dying in the war. And so Chaya, his wife, lost her husband in this war. But she's quoted in Nechamatek's book as saying, the reeds were so high. And that's what was so beautiful. Michael Bielski told me that when they were going through the swamp, he said that's what kept the reconnaissance planes from being able to find 800 Jews in the middle of a swamp. They couldn't see them. They were literally hidden by those reeds. At the Gulf of Aqaba, it's 8.5 miles across too, by the way. And the fact that Tuvia is referred to by the survivors as their modern day Moses, so many things that it was just mind-boggling. And the rabbis, as I begin to talk to different rabbis, rabbis that I knew personally, Rabbi Minkowitz for one, Rabbi Minkowitz, he said, I can agree with the fact of Jeremiah 23 as far as Yam Suf being the Gulf of Aqaba, and I'm not sure. But one rabbi in particular, Rabbi Mandy, a rabbi down in Bonita Springs, Florida, he brought out an interesting point to me when we first began to speak about the story together. He said, you know, I can really believe this to be true. And he said, you should know as well as I do what really gives a lot of strength to this story is what Moses says in Exodus 15. Now, I'm going to read to you Exodus 15. Shemot is the chapter, or the book, excuse me, the book we're going to go to and look at this. And this is something I write about in the book, and I think it's important that you may find very interesting as well. Because it gives strength for several different things that God has opened my heart to understand. In chapter 15, in verse 1, it says here in the English language, "Then Moses and the children of Israel chose to sing this song." Now, it doesn't actually say the word chose in the Hebrew language, but that's how they translate it. I don't know why they did that either. Let me get it for you in the Christian Bible. It'd be better. It doesn't say anything about they chose to sing the song. It just says they sang this song. Let me just read it to you here. "Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea." All right, now, in Hebrew it says, "Az Yeshia Moshe, Uvene Yisrael et Hashira." By the way, that's Shemot Tetvav, Yukidah Tetvav, and verse Aleph, first verse. Exodus 15. "Az Yeshia Moshe Uvene Yisrael et Hashira Hazot Ladonai, Veyamu Lemor." And they said, "Ashira l'Adonai ki ga'aga'o, Ashira, I will sing." This is a future tense song, and it's something that Rashi points out in the Midrash. "Sus l'erkevo rama b'yom," the horse and his rider are cast into the sea. I didn't say anything to Rabbi Mendy at the time when he said this to me, but immediately, the first thing that come to my mind when I read this here, and as Rabbi Mendy pointed out, he says, you know, Rashi says, "Ashira l'Adonai ga'ago, I will sing unto the Lord," is a future tense song. It's a song of redemption that's yet to be sung. Now, Rabbi Mendy, if you ever happen to watch this video, let me share with you something from the Christian reading. And it's the same corresponding chapter, which makes it even more ironic. If you go to Revelation chapter 15, it says, "And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having the seven last plagues, wherein them is filled up with the wrath of God." "And I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire," a final exodus. "And them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name stand on the sea of glass having the harps of God. And they sing the song of Moses." Wow. Now it's interesting that they sing the song of Moses. Now it doesn't mention that Moses is there. But if he's killed as one of the two witnesses, he's not supposed to be there. This is in the last part of this Daniel's 70th week. "They sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb." Wow, what do you know? They recognize who Mashiach is and who's the one that teaches them this song? Moses does. And who does he teach? What does he teach them when he returns? Who Mashiach is. And of course, any Christian knows that Lamb is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. "Great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. Who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou only art holy, for all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest." Now notice, his judgments are manifest. He's about to judge that Antichrist. And as Moses points out here, "Ashira l'Adonai He's cast the horse and his rider into the sea. What about the 600? What about the other 599? Why does Moses sing about only one and he speaks of it as a future tense song? Because Moses comes back along with Elijah to challenge Satan when he's incarnated in the Antichrist. And his horse and his rider, the rider that Satan chooses to use, the Antichrist, the horse, you know, that's why God brings all nations down to Jerusalem for battle. He's bringing them to judgment. So the United Nations forces will go right down with it. Wow. Interesting times
we had. All sorts of difficult trials.
The survivors would often refer to Tubia as their modern-day Moses. He takes on a nature totally different from his brothers in that he wants to rescue as many of his people as he can. Hides them into the woods, and just like the children of Israel, they keep moving about.
It is also, though, historically and biblically true. And the idea of Jews forced to wander without a home from one place to the other in the wilderness, in the desert, in search of a home, is Old Testament.
It's very difficult to juxtapose biblical theology onto modern day scenarios.
The reason this is so intriguing, we're following threads that may not have been followed by looking at the backside and realizing that the whole thing is literally designed.
Ironically, no one, even from the movie, no one from history thus far has ever put two and two together that they actually cross a sea of reeds.
It does make one think that something special, something unique, something perhaps divine is happening.
Thank you for watching this broadcast. If you would like to be a part of this ministry, you can send your tax-free gift to Denoon Institute at 12537 Gemstone Crescent, Fort Myers, Florida 33913, or you can give securely online at www.israelreturns.com. For more resources, visit our website again at www.israelreturns.com. Also, please visit our YouTube channel, Ben Denoon. We would like to thank some of our valued friends for making this broadcast possible. Thank you for being with us. We trust that tonight's program has been a blessing.